Okay, welcome to GADEPS. We are pleased today to have Jan-Willem van Intersu from Max Planck. Thank you, Jan-Willem, for accepting, and you can start.
Okay, well, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm happy to speak to you today. And as you see, there are three words or three parts ingredients in my title: shifted symmetric functions, quasi-modular forms, and Hamiltonian operators. And I would say these three aspects together form one story I would like to tell you. So this story started in physics with the work of the Dutch physicist Robert Dijkgraaf, and then was brought into mathematics, and his conjectures were proven rigorously by Kaneko and Tonzadze. This is what I will be explaining today. And then there we will also see this shifted symmetric functions in these quasi-modular forms. And then in the end, I will come back to physics, because it turned out that more recent results in this area again then gets, well, inspiration from Hamiltonian operators in mathematical physics. This is what I want to explain you today. So, but to get started, I will start with the shifted symmetric functions, because this, I think they're the easiest to start with. And shifted symmetric functions are functions defined on partitions. So for me, lambda is a partition, and P is the set of all partitions. So a partition that is a finite sequence of integers, or you can also take it to be an infinite sequence, what I would rather do. And this sequence then is decreasing to zero, such that the sum of all the elements in the sequence is always finite. So this is this number, the absolute value of lambda, is the integer that lambda is a partition of. And so now we have so these partitions, and you can count for each integer how many partitions there are. And in case you have all these numbers, it's a good way to study them is by considering their generating series. So this is how this story of today starts. We take the generating series of all partitions. So we sum over all partitions, and then here in the exponent we have the integer where this is a partition of. And already Euler considered this generating series and gave the following expression for it, like this, the infinite product. And in this infinite product, we recognize the Dedekind eta function. So this function is the Dedekind eta, and here I wrote, as will be implicit in the rest of the talk, that Q is e to the power 2 pi I tau. So this Dedekind eta function is the first example of a modular form we will see. So in general,
sorry, I think your generating series needs coefficients.
I'm sorry, what do you mean?
Your series does not have the coefficient, the generating series.
Yeah, but I'm summing over all the set of all partitions. So the coefficients, so there are I'm taking Q to the power absolute value of lambda. So so I can also write this in a different way. So what I'm doing is I'm summing over n, and I'm taking all the set of all n such that the absolute value is lambda. I take the size of that and then Q to the power n. This is what
Exactly.
And this is often, this is written as the sum over n p n of q to the power n, where p n is the number of partitions of n.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I wrote it in a slightly different way than is standard, but this is what I mean with it. Yes. Okay, so we were at this Dedekind eta function, the first example of a modular form, and I wanted to give you a quick definition of modular forms, only for the group SL2Z. So in this particular case, we know that these spaces, the space of modular forms, is generated by the Eisenstein series, even these two Eisenstein series, where EK, in a slightly different normalization than you might be used to, but this is the normalization I would like for to propose for today, are defined as follows. So these are other examples of modular forms, and they are related to the Dedekind eta function. Namely, if you take the 24th power of the eta function, this is a well-known delta function, and then you get minus 12, oh, sorry, minus 24 e4 cubed minus 504 e6 squared over 1728. So this is the first relation of the eta functions to the Eisen series. And then the second one is that the logarithmic derivative, so here I wrote d for the usual derivative, but then normalized by 1 over 2 pi I, which then in terms of the Fourier expansion take this nice form. Then the logarithmic derivative of the eta function is minus the E2 Eisenstein series. So we see that if we start from partitions, we quickly arrive at the realm of modular forms and also even quasi-modular forms. E2 is an example of a quasi-modular form, and a quasi-modular form are extensions of this space of modular forms by also allowing this E2 Eisenstein series among the generators. There's also an intrinsic definition of all this, which generalizes to congruent subgroups, but I won't be talking about that today. But what is important for this space of quasi-modular forms, and also to understand them, is that there is an action of this differential operator D on quasi-modular forms. So you have these famous equations by Ramanujan, which expresses the derivative of the Eisenstein series, or the first three Eisenstein series, in terms of the others. And since this D is a derivation, this suffices to show that D is really a derivation on the space of quasi-modular forms. So I give you here this three Ramanujan equations. Okay, sorry, my pen is not reacting correctly at this moment, but this is a 7. I'm sorry for that. Okay, so we have this derivation here. And then what is important to understand quasi-modular forms, although we will not actually need it, but I want to say this to give you a bit of a better understanding of what quasi-modular forms are is that if you have a quasi-modular form, then as I said, there's this differential operator D, which maps a quasi-modular form, so again, to its derivative, and that's then the weight goes up by two. So each Eisenstein series, I didn't say it, but each Eisenstein series EK has weight K. So these modular forms are graded algebra. And so there are also these three operators on them, which respect the weight grading. So there's this W operator, which just multiplies a quasi-modular form by its weight. And lastly, there's a third operator, which in terms of the way we defined quasi-modular forms today, takes the four following forms. So every quasi-modular form can be written as a polynomial in E2 by definition, and then we take the derivative with respect to E2, and then there is a constant of minus a half in front. And this last operator just lowers the weight by two, because E2 has weight two. And what is important about these operators is that together they form an action of the Lie algebra SL2 on quasi-modular forms. So what does it mean? It means that if you compute the commutators of these operators, then this is the most important commutator. If you compute these commutator, you get the weight, and these two ones are just so the commutator of the weight with D is 2 times D, because D increases the weight by 2, and with the other matfrac D operator, it lowers the weight by 2. So we get these three commutation relations, which help us to understand quasi-modular forms. Okay, now I've introduced quasi-modular forms and also a bit of their relation to partitions. I can come to the story I promised to tell you. So Dijkgraaf, at the time before I was born, in around 1994, 93, I think, he was studying the mirror symmetry. In dimension one. So the picture of this, what you should have in mind is that he was counting curves in a Calabi-Yau manifold of dimension one, which you then also can translate in counting certain ramified coverings of a torus. So this is a torus, a Riemann surface of genus one, and here there's another Riemann surface of genus G, and we are counting the number of degree D mappings, which are ramified, because there are no holomorphic mappings between these two, but there are mappings if you allow certain ramifications. In fact, these kinds of numbers can very concretely being written down. So HGD is the weighted number of such mappings. They can be very concretely being given in terms of the following counting problem in the symmetric group. So we are counting 2G elements in the symmetric group, which satisfy the following properties. First of all, that the commutator of A and B times the other elements is the identity. And secondly, that all the CI lie in the fixed cogency class of transpositions, which I write down by the letter T. So I think if you want, with some results from a bachelor's course in group theory and maybe some representations of finite groups, you are able to count these numbers. But the surprising thing is that before Dijkgraaf, nobody had taken interest in these numbers. But let me say a bit more about them. So we have a sequence of numbers. So again, what we do is we take the generating series of these numbers. So we are summing now over D, and then we do taking this generating series, and then the conjecture by Robert Dijkgraaf was that these sequences are always in the space of quasi-modular forms, and even that the weight of these elements is at most 6g by minus 6. There's also a variation, so these numbers correspond to counting possibly disconnected coverings. You can also make the coverings connected and get a slightly different counting problem, and don't have this caveat here of mixed weight. I won't focus on that today, but what I want to do is to show you an example of this. Namely, this is a conjectured for G at least 2, so let's just take the easiest example of such a sequence, then we will get 2q squared plus 16q cubed plus 60q to the power 4 plus 160q to the fifth plus more terms. So if you want, at a certain point during the talk or after the talk, you would be able to compute these numbers also yourself by using the definition of HDD. Which I gave you. And let me, for reference, also next to it now, put these first two examples of the Eisenstein series. The first one being a quasi-modular form, and the second one being an actual modular form. Then these Eisenstein series have the following expansion. Well, it goes on as well, and then this Eisenstein series, we find the following coefficients, 9, 28, 30, 73, 126, etc. And if you would stare long enough at these series, you would see there's a relation between these three, namely, in this particular case, it is true that H2 is the derivative of E4, well, this is a quasi-modular form of H6, minus the double derivative of E2, which is also a quasi-modular form of H6, and 6G minus C, 6G minus 6 in this time is indeed 6, and then we have to multiply with a third. So here you see this conjecture of Dijkgraaf in action. This is the first example of the quasi-modular forms, one obtained by studying these counting problems originating from mirror symmetry in dimension 1. What I want to do now, also to introduce the shifted symmetric functions on partitions, which I have not introduced so far, as I want to give a sketch of the proof, or at least of the three main steps in the proof. What I also want to point out is that in Dijkgraaf's resolve, he chose all the CI to be transpositions, or rather he chose the ramification to be as simple as possible, which corresponds to taking transpositions. But in fact, as turned out later, you can also replace transpositions by any other coherency class in the symmetric group, and then the proof still works. So I will now present a proof which applies in greater generality, this proof, I then present is, well, the proof of the conjecture by Dijkgraaf, then which was then first proven by Kaneko and Zajay, but the proof I use makes also use of refined results by Bloch and Akunkov, and all these results together then imply that these sequence HD, but also the more like generalizations by taking different quantity classes, are all quasi-modular forms of some prescribed weight. Yes. So let me get into the into this proof now. And the first thing we have to do is to find a better expression for these numbers H, G, D. And what you can do by using representation theory of the symmetric groups is write these HGDs in terms of sums over partitions, because the partitions correspond to coincidence classes in the symmetric group, but they also correspond to the characters of the symmetric group, because the characters of the symmetric group can be in a unique canonical way, they correspond to partitions as well. And that is what we use here, because we have here now this central character new corresponding to transpositions. So this central character, this is the action of the sum of all transpositions in the group algebra acting on the module from the representation corresponding to lambda. So this is said in words, but explicitly I can also write down a formula for you. So this is the size of the Coincy class of transposition. So implicitly this depends on D, because the size of lambda is D, and we now count the size of transpositions in the symmetric group as D. And then we multiply with the representation or the character of the representation corresponding to lambda evaluated at T, and we divide by the dimension of the representation. So this we then think of as being a function from partitions to the integers. I write Q here because later we will consider other functions which do not take values necessarily in the integers, but this function takes values then in the integers. Okay, so this is the first step in the proof by giving a nice expression for these functions in terms of functions on partitions. Now we go on and we introduce shifted symmetric functions. So let me first write down shifted symmetric, the algebra of shifted symmetric functions formally. So we have certain generators, QK, for every K, which all have weight K. So this is a formal polynomial algebra in these QK generators. And the first one we have already seen before, because this is minus 1 over 24 plus the size of lambda, or the integer lambda is a partition of. And then the second generator we also have seen before, namely this is exactly this character or the central character corresponding to transpositions. And then this continues, and in general QK, but also including K is 2 or 3, has the following expression. Well, I leave some space because there will be a constant in front, but the main part of shifted symmetric functions is the sum over all indices, and it will be lambda I to the power k minus 1. This I would say is the main part, but they are not called symmetric functions, but they are called shifted symmetric functions. And there is the shift here by the index. And then for normalization, we also add a half to them. This will be a divergent sum, but we can make it convergent by adding this additional term to it. So this is a shifted symmetric function without its constant term. And then for convenience, later on, we also have here the constant term added to it. Here, bk again is the Bernoulli numbers, which you also saw in the definition of the Eisenstein series. Okay, this is in general what shifted symmetric functions are. You can check that is if k is 2, this would give the original, this would give the same as the expression I wrote here for Q2. Okay. Yes, and then for the last part, we should explain how we now go from these shifted symmetric functions. So the second step says that one gives an expression for these numbers we are interested in terms of shifted symmetric functions. And now we should somehow go from shifted symmetric functions to quasi-modular forms. And for that, in the third step, the following definition is very useful, namely the definition of the Q bracket.
Yeah, I'm a little bit confused. In the when you started, lambda was was using just finite sequence, but now lambda is an infinite sequence, no?
Oh yes, sorry, I switched between these two perspectives. So if you have a finite sequence, you can add infinitely many zeros to it, then it becomes an infinite sequence, and that's what you do. Sometimes people consider partitions as a finite sequence without zeros, and sometimes as infinite sequences which converge to zero.
I see.
That's the way to go from the one to the other perspective. And then, yes, I here in this sum, indeed, I wrote down as if it were infinite sequences. Yes. Yes, thank you for asking.
Something, although I have not seen this one in this first article of Diagraph. So it has contributed in the subsequent articles, or it is in the same article that conjectures the quasi-modularity of HGs.
Yes. So the story is, I'm taking merged things of the history together. So Diagraph did this conjecture but didn't prove it. Then in the same volume of the journal, Kaneko and Zajic proved this conjecture, but it was not this proof I'm presenting now, because they didn't have these functions qk for all k, they only have q3. There. And then later, Bloch and Okunkov in the year 2000 introduced all these functions qk. And if you use all of them, then you would give the proof I am now giving. I'm not presenting. So this is not historically correct.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is this one and two is mainly the contribution of Kaneko Zagir and Bloch Okunkov, because I don't remember.
Yes. Yeah, so Diagraph's main contribution was the conjecture and not the proof, because he's a physicist, so he was not really giving a proof in this paper. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So the mathematical side with the proofs is coming from Kaneko Zajic and Bloch and Okunkov. Yes. Yes, and one of the things we need now to finish the proof was the Q bracket, I said. So this is the Q bracket of some function from partitions to Q. And so we associate to such a function the following Q series. Namely, what do? We, so to say, take the generating series of this function, and then, so we're summing over all partitions, and then we normalize by the generating series of partitions. We already saw that before, and then this becomes some formal Q series. Yes, and let's just see an example of that. Q series, and there's one case in which you can easily compute what this Q bracket is, namely if you take the Q bracket of Q2, I recall this is -1/24 plus the number lambda as a partition of, so this is -1/24 plus, if you plug it in, the sum over the, well, this ratios of sums over partitions, and this -1/24, we keep it out, but what we recognize is here is a logarithmic derivative of the generating series of partitions, and once we recognize that, we remember that this is minus 1 over 24, and then we plug in what we know about this generating series of partitions, which I started my talk with today, namely this is Q over 1 over 24, and then eta to the power minus 1. And then remember that the logarithmic derivative of eta is the E2 Eisenstein series, so then you find that this is indeed the E2 Eisenstein series. So the Q bracket of Q2, one can easily compute, and it's the E2 Eisenstein series. In general, this is not so easy. It's far from easy, I would say, to compute Q bracket of shifted symmetric function, but this is what where the work of Bloch and Okunkov comes in, because they show that this Q bracket is a quasi-modular form for all shifted symmetric functions. Yes, so for this class of shifted symmetric functions, they show that this is always the case, and they also give an expression for what would the Q bracket be in this case in terms of coefficients of a certain ratio of theta series. And this is a very interesting result. Well, first you now see that if you combine all these steps, we express first these numbers in terms of shifted symmetric functions, and then we know, because the Q brackets are quasi-modular forms, that also these numbers, the generating series of these numbers, are also quasi-modular forms. So this is the first thing. So this completes the sketch of the proof. And then the second thing is that this result, as I said, it's not by Bloch and Okunkov, is not an easy result, for the reason that this Q bracket is not an algebra homomorphism.
One question. So in this definition and theorem, this lambda shifted symmetric functions are finite sequence, not really infinite.
So these QKs are here finite sums indeed, because at a certain point this sum becomes zero.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. So this indeed. Yes. So this are just Yes. So what I was saying is the Q bracket, so the quasi-modular forms and shifted symmetric functions form graded algebras of functions. But the Q bracket is not an algebra homomorphism. It's a linear map, but it doesn't respect the multiplicative structure. And this is what makes this result so strong. A very useful for applications. Well, the first application we now have already seen in proving this result of Dijkgraaf, but then also later work on Zygovich constants in modelized spaces of flat surfaces. There also this modularity of the Q bracket of shifted symmetric functions played a large technical role in the proof there. And later in my talk, I will give another applications of these functions on partitions and quasi-modular forms. But before I do that, I want to raise some other questions. If you see this result by Bloch, and also on this result by Bloch and Okunkov, namely the question, is this really the only kind of results, or are there similar results and generalizations? And you can ask these questions in many ways. So one thing you can ask is, here we have the symmetric group, but for all D, but maybe if we take another infinite family of groups, you can also maybe do something. That's the first question. Then the second question is where does this shift come from? Here's shifted symmetric functions, they have some shift. Do we really need these shifts? And then the last question, I said the Q bracket is not an algebra homomorphism. And the other question is, okay, but can we maybe find some more algebraic properties of the Q bracket? And all these questions together lead to the following. Well, one way to answer some of the questions I said something about replacing SD by another group. Well, in the literature of normative geometry, there is something like spin groups corresponding to some variations of these countings of covering. So this is the spin groups fit in the following exact sequence by the action of the symmetric group by the sign on set two. But maybe a better way to see it anyway is just to think about the second question, where we forget about the shift. So what we do, what we can do, is define functions dk just by taking the powers of all the parts and without any shifting. And I so here again, at a certain point, this sum terminates, it becomes zero. And I, for convenience, added also the constant term to it. And then it turns out that these functions tk also have a lot to do with the representation theory of the spin symmetric group. So that these central characters for the spin symmetric group can also be represented in terms of these functions tk. So both questions lead to the same functions. I will bring these functions now to the next page. Okay, let me then continue with my third question. I asked something about algebraic structure, and one way to do that and to answer that question is to write down the following diagram. So this is what we already have. We have the Q bracket as a mapping from functions on partitions to Q series. So it may be nicer if we would have an easier mapping to Q series. And one of the things you could imagine is take here infinite series in these variables, infinitely many variables, ui, and then taking a nice mapping, which is just replacing ui by q to the power I. So this is a much easier mapping to study. And the reason why this also works is that there is also a nice mapping here in the diagram, which makes it commute. Namely, what we can do is we can define what is the U bracket of a function. So we saw the Q bracket, but what we do now is more like a refined version, so to say. We don't put here Q to the power the size of lambda, but we put here U lambda one, so the first part of lambda U, lambda two, etc. And then divided by U lambda one, U lambda two, where if you want, we set U zero to be one. So we have here sums over partitions, and the denominator turns out to be invertible, so that this indeed is an element of the space where we want it to be. And this U bracket is now very nice because we can use it to understand more of the algebraic structure, and in particular, in the example of the functions tk I just defined, we get that the U bracket is minus bk over 2k, okay, just a constant, but now we get here the sum over m and r, m to the power k minus 1, u m to the power r. And this is really good, because this implies that if you would take the Q bracket, well, you would just take the same constant term, but now you would replace u m by q to the power m times r. And this is how I defined the Eisenstein series. So here you see that, or at least if k is even, that these Q brackets of these tk's are quasi-modular form. So this is a good thing to have, but not everything yet, because we want more. We want to have an algebra of functions and not only one particular function. So in other words, we want also that polynomials in these functions tk give quasi-modular forms after the Q bracket, just as the case for the Bloch-Gonkov theorem. And this is actually a true but even stronger result is true, because we see here we get years a certain polynomial in the variables m and r, namely just the k minus 1 power. But we can also do this in general, so we can take any polynomial in two variables and then map it to the sum over m and r, p, m, r, u, m, to the power r. And I do it like this because I know that if you would then go on and replace ui with q to the power I, then you will get some element of the space of quasi-modular forms. And this is a construction which works really well. Namely, we let T to be the algebra generated under multiplication by, well, the inverse under the U bracket. U bracket is an isomorphism, in fact, so there's also an inverse to it of polynomials, where we embed polynomials as by this inclusion here on the left of the diagram. So this is some other algebra of functions on particular functions on partition, and in particular it contains all polynomials in these TK functions. And then the result is that for this algebra, the same result applies as for the Bloch-Okunkov theorem, namely that the Q bracket of these functions are always quasi-modular forms as well. And it should be said, these functions in the space T are really different from the ones from the shifted symmetric one. So these are more like the symmetric functions, so to say, where previously we had shifted symmetric functions. So we now have a second algebra with similar properties, and maybe even more properties, because we now also have this diagram which explains us more about the algebraic structure. And in particular, we now have a strange phenomena that there's a product here, and also a product on the top space above, and a product here. And here we also have more structure like an involution. So there's a lot what this has to do with the algebraic structure of multiple zeta values, where I will not be talking about today, but there are a lot of relations to that as well, as I did in another project with Henrik Bachmann, who also at a certain point, I think, gave a talk in your seminar. But I'm now just mentioning it, and what I want to focus on in the last part of my talk is one application of this last result. And this application comes, as I said, from mathematical physics, because now we will see for the first time these Hamiltonian operators. These Hamiltonian operators, they come from the Kortweg de Vries equation, the KdV equation, which is an equation describing waves. And these associated to these equations are infinitely many conserved quantities, which gives rise to infinitely many Hamiltonians. And these Hamiltonians have been generalized by a lot of people. In particular, there have been given quantum Hamiltonians. And this is the kind of operators I will be speaking about today. And in particular, I will be speaking about certain quantum operators which were introduced first by Eliasberg and then later generalized by Burjak and Rossi. So these are operators indexed by an integer k and then polynomials in epsilon, which are commuting, and they are differential operators because they are quantum, and they act on the space delta consisting of polynomials in P1, P2, etc., where the weight of each pk is defined to be k. Okay, so yes. And let us focus for now first at what happens if we take epsilon is zero. So this is the original case of Eliasberg. So then we have an operator gk, which is gk of zero. And as I said, these are all commuting differential operators. So in particular, they admit a simultaneous basis of eigenvectors and eigenvalues. And these were made explicit by Dubrovin. Dubrovin. Namely, the sure functions are the eigenvectors, and the shifted symmetric functions, which we saw before, these are the eigenvalues. This is what he proved.
Are these GKR explicit or?
I will, so I decided not to define the GK operators because it would take too much time now, but I will give you, after this, I will give you some examples of the first few. Well, actually, I can also do that now because I can imagine that you want to see what they are. So I will write it below. At least can write down the zeroth one. This is minus 1 over 24 plus the sum over a p a d p a, and g 1 is 1. So the first one, as you see, doesn't depend on epsilon. So I should write here, in principle, they depend on epsilon, but the first one is of degree 0 in epsilon. And now the g 1 is of degree 1 in epsilon. So first, there's the part which does not depend on epsilon. This is this part, and then there's the second part, which is epsilon times 1 over 124 plus the sum over a cubed. Yes, and they all look like this, except that if k becomes bigger, it becomes more complicated and complicated and longer expressions. So yes, this is what I can say for now, how they look like. Yes, and so then it was proven by by Dubrovin that the shifted symmetric functions are the eigenvalues. So let me put this a bit down. So let me say, what are these eigenvectors first? So these are the sure functions, and in terms of the power sums, how we should think about these p's, they are given in terms of the characters of the symmetric group as follows, where p, so c nu is the absolute value of c nu is the size of the cogency class of the partition nu, and this is the character of the representation according to lambda at the cogency class corresponding to nu, and p nu is just the product of p nu I. Okay, this is what this explicitly is, but what is of interest to us is that one for any g, so g a differential operator on the same space delta, one could define the bracket corresponding to g to be the following ratio, which one makes one think again of the Q bracket. Namely, we take the trace of the operator summed over all n, and then so we take the trace of the operator on the weight n parts of delta, and then we divide by the dimension of delta But because of this weight grading, we chose on delta, this denominator is just the generating series of partitions, this whole denominator. The important bit again, of course, is the numerator. But because we know these are...
Sorry, what is delta in?
Oh, a delta. Delta is...
delta n.
And n is the weight n part. So All elements which have weight n. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome. Yes, and now in particular for let me write it here. For this operators GK, we can now compute these brackets. Because we know that on the diagonal basis, the QK are these QKs are the eigenvalues. So this is actually equal to the Q bracket of the QKs, which we know by the Bloch-Kunckhoff theorem is a quasi-modular form. This result of Dibrowson implies that the Q series associated the trace sum, so to say, associated to an operator in the case of these operators of Eliasberg, Bouillac, and Rossi give quasi modular forms. We now, for that result, only looked at these operators for the epsilon and zero part. But what you also can do is define the epsilon going to infinity limit. So that is defined like this. And now I can give, I can be explicit because this limit I can explicitly write down what the operators are. So again, there's this constant we have seen already a few times before. And now it's the sum over a to the power 2k plus 1, p a d d p a. This is what the last coefficient in epsilon of the operators is. What you then can find is that these operators, which are also commuting, still commuting, so there's still a simultaneous basis of eigenvectors, then these eigenvectors become the basis elements, p lambda. So I recall p lambda is the product of the p lambda I, and the eigen values are exactly these functions, t to the power 2k plus 2. Oh, I see I made a small mistake here. This should be b, there's some shift here, 2k plus 2 over 2k plus 2. Should be like this. So also for this infinity part, we see that you get nice eigen values, and not only nice, these are exactly the other functions I defined on partitions for which the Q bracket is a quasi-modular form. So these operators, however they are defined, give sort of an interpolation between the Bloch-Kunckhoff theorem and the other theorem giving expressing certain functions as quasi-modular forms. So one of the first things you then could ask, what happens if you consider the modularities of these series in epsilon in generality, because this would imply that also the GK infinity part of the series is a quasi-modular form by the theorem we saw before. So what would happen if we do not specialize epsilon? What happens in generality? And this was a joint project with Julia Rucha. And there we found that even in generality, these series corresponding to these operators, these trace sums, are quasi-modular forms. Well, they are polynomials in quasi-modular forms, and we should think of epsilon as being a formal parameter of weight minus one. And then of this whole thing, we take the part which is of weight k plus two. So this is then the statement that in general, these operators give rise to quasi-modular forms. And how would you prove such a result? The idea is that...
So weight k plus 2, considering also epsilon weighted, no? Epsilon together with e2, e4, e6.
Yeah. Sorry, there's brackets here, yeah. Yes, so epsilon is weighted with weight minus 1. And then quasi-modular forms are weighted. So together, this polynomial space becomes a graded space. And then of this whole space, I take the k plus 2 part. Indeed.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, so how would you prove a result? Well, if you could find a basis, well, it's known there exists a basis, and if you would be able to find the basis on which these operators are diagonal, then it would maybe be easier. But it turns out that that's not an easy problem, or at least nobody knows how to find the diagonal basis. But for these traces, it does not really matter. So what we do is we choose our favorite basis, namely the basis of these functions, p lambda, which is the simplest basis. And what we then do is by using the definitions of these operators, which I've not given today, but we use it to show that this is actually always an element in our space T. And if you can prove it using the definitions of these operators, then you are there, because we know that for elements in this space, the Q bracket is always a quasi-modular form. So this then gives a first application of this new space T, for which also all Q brackets are quasi-modular forms. Yes, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Yamil. Any question for recorded session?
I have some comment maybe after recording.
So maybe we can stop the recording and then...